get started. I'll probably want to stand up anyway, but yeah, let's get the fourth chair. Okay. We had Mike and I had lunch yesterday, and I was talking with Steve over dinner, and I chatted with Olivier before this session, and kind of an interesting kind of differences in perspectives here. So I think, first of all, let's just do a quick introduction about who you are. Just please keep it brief so we can get into the discussion.
My name is Michael Amundsen. I work as an API architect for a company called Layer 7, which is part of CA. And I focus a lot on large-scale systems and the use of hypermedia.
Hi, I'm Olivier Ricoux from EPITA. I do research there. And I'm a quite old guy on the internet since I've made my 25 years now. And I'm just involved in geopolitics about the internet.
Hi, I'm Steve. If you go to my company's website, Balance Payments, the About page says my job title is Philosopher in Residence, Ideas, Collaboration, Standards, and HTTP Nerd. So I think that works.
And I'm Alex Williams, enterprise writer for TechCrunch. And so we were having lunch yesterday, and we were thinking, well, what are we going to talk about? This is a pretty broad area. And I'm like, well, there's a lot of things we can talk about. And you know, we came up with this kind of a whole idea of automation. And I was talking with Olivier, and he was talking about kind of where protocols are going. And Stephen, you know, has a very diverse background, and so he's the philosopher of the group. So we'll, you know, let him talk on topics related to, you know, these trends that we were talking over lunch and I was talking with Olivier about. So we were thinking, though, you know, I never expected, actually, I come to this event and start talking about like libertarianism, which I think there's a deep strain of libertarianism in technology circles. And you see it quite a bit. And I was talking a little bit beforehand about, you know, about this topic. And so I think it plays a lot into where the world is going. And I'm just curious, are there any libertarians here in the room? Raise your hand.
I won't look.
You don't have to raise your hand, but I mean, I'm just looking for conversation. Because we're just curious about, you know, how that plays into the future of the web and what it means, because the companies that are really propelling things forward do have a deep libertarian strain. And it's just an interesting contrast, but we'll get back to that in a little bit. What I would like to talk with you guys about, maybe we'll start with you, Olivier, is about what you're seeing emerge right now. For instance, you know, we're seeing this emergence really of this kind of this of these JavaScript developers, and curious on where you see things going with the protocols, and you know, where they've been in your experiences over the past 30 years or so.
Okay, so I'm not that just a guy of protocols. I mean, I say just more politics either. What I've seen since at the end of the 80s when I arrived, so it was before the internet, so before we had HTTP and we had plenty of protocols, everything was open, so it was easy to get information about anyone using Finger across all the internet, and you know that that's why he was connected to his computer from that time to that time. And then the web arrived. We had internet already. And people used it more and more, and internet opened to everyone. So in the middle of the 90s, you had so many people connected that you had to close all these services like Finger or FTP or whatever was open and dangerous. Because now it started to be dangerous on the internet. And days after days, years after years, all port has been closed, and only HTTP was open in companies, of course, HTTPS also. So it made many things different. If you want to make a new service, you have no choice but to use HTTP. I mean, you can do something else, but then you know that you are not able to go through companies or many places like that. Of course, at home, you can use them. But it restricts. So people use HTTP everywhere. And now I have a kind of feeling that internet protocol is HTTP. IP is something a lower layer. What I see also is that with JavaScript, you have more and more possibilities to make heavy client inside of the browser, which is a nonsense because heavy client was outside. It was a dedicated software, so you can talk to a server. But dedicated client and server means dedicated port, and you want to use port 80. And even worse, you have to install software, which means libraries on the computers of people. So if you can put everything inside Firefox or whatever you want using JavaScript, then you have something which is very efficient. And I can see big companies now who had plenty of softwares using client and servers, and now they're switching on to everything inside the browser, so they don't have any more firewall problems, they don't have any more libraries installed on any of their computers. So it seems that everything now turns to be JavaScript. And because of that, companies who make browser like Firefox, Chrome for Google, or et cetera like that, they just make JavaScript so efficient today that it is very impressive. I mean, I've seen some meshes, you know, when you do 3D meshes and you have to view objects with almost a million of triangles, and it was moving so fast that it was just amazing, and you couldn't do that before. So it's now very efficient. You can do everything through the web. So the next question is, what are we going to have for the future? I mean, do we have to stay in HTTP for everything? Can we have local protocol for, as you said, Internet of things? So, okay, now we can talk maybe of these things if you
there
want.
There we go, perfect. So I think that does bring us back to this conversation about speed. And for speed, you need automation. And with automation comes trade-offs and choices. Mike? What are some of those trade-offs and choices that we are going to have to think about?
Yeah, we were talking about this, and I'm really, I share your same feeling. So I started this in the 80s as well. I think we probably
started in the 80s.
You did not start in the
80s. He did start.
He started
in the 80s. Yeah.
He started.
Yeah. Nothing before the internet.
But to see the shift from the series of protocols to HTTP is primary because of busting the firewall. And now I think when we get more and more devices, more and more of these small devices, that HTTP is going to be relatively ineffective because these very small devices aren't going to be all server and all client, and you're not going to be writing script on them. They're going to be these cheap little pieces of things in your shoes or in your clothes, and they all need to talk together. And one of the things we talked about is the notion that for them to talk together, it's going to be terribly ineffective to talk to some server far away, so that to have your shoe talk to your brain or something, to go to some other server and come back again. They're going to start talking directly to each other. And when we start talking directly to each other, we become our own network. We become our own node. And that's going to be very, very different. And I think we'll be using different protocols like CoAP or MQTT or some of these other UDP-based protocols that can broadcast, which is something that HTTP doesn't do right now.
So, Steve, I would like to hear from your perspective, from what Mike's saying here about kind of like that contained network, the individual. And I think this does where you have to start thinking about what really is what power do we want to provide those cloud services? I mean, you could talk about it on a very broad level, but I think almost more so in terms of efficiency. If you're going to be managing your own network internally, is it even efficient, to start using third-party services, to do that? Or do you need that combination of the two? Where do you see this system of automation progressing?
So the cycle is always about centralization and then decentralization,
right?
And it goes back and forth and back and forth.
Yeah.
So we had super centralized everything, and then we developed the web, and everything became decentralized, and everybody ran their own stuff. And then people realized you could make money on the internet, so they started re-centralizing everything so they could collect a piece of the pie, right? So like Facebook wants to be AOL, who wants to be the internet, right? And everything is owned by one company. So I'm interested in this local network idea simply because it allows you to have autonomy over your own data and your own everything, because now I don't have to Facebook connect to my shoes if I am like directly,
Facebook soul.
Right. Yeah. So a truly decentralized protocol would not only allow for these local networks, but would also allow for some degree of lack of control. I think that companies are much better at dealing with decentralized control and influencing networks. It is harder to do that than with a centralized thing. So it's not only about efficiency, but about like control, basically.
I also think this brings us right to trust, right? So if I'm sort of managing my space, it has to be usable and accessible for me to set up trusts between different things. So I trust my shoes, I trust my phone, I trust my house, whatever that would be, so that we can talk together. But I may not set up a trust with you, right? So when we meet, we have these sort of barriers we have to deal with. It's going to be very different if we decentralize.
Except if you're a source, you know, then we can. I don't know.
Then there may be things. Only if it's on background, I think, is what I'm supposed to say. But there are going to be some other ways that we're going to have to arrange that, and that's going to be a new set of challenges: a decentralized trust, decentralized authentication, as well as authorization. Is something that we still struggle with even today. We're trying to do this in a couple of ways, but I don't think we've figured it out yet at the level that we're going to need to make sure that as we're walking around, people aren't actually glomming onto our devices and finding things out about us.
Well,
there's someone here with Google Glass.
Yeah, I've seen someone with Google Glass. That's right.
And violation of trust and like things like that.
That's what's a great point. I don't think you can expect this trust that much because people want to get services. And for example, if you have a device which just monitor your heart pace, you want that the hospital can get the information. So you said you don't need HTTP because it's a local network, but this local network has to talk to the internet and to go through firewalls. So then again, you may have these troubles. And then you said about centralization, which is very right. And many people, they put their data on Facebook because they want that. And maybe they want their shoes to be connected to Facebook.
Or they don't know. I mean, are they really cognizant of it all? I mean, are they really cognizant of their data being on Facebook and their, you know, where their data is at all? I don't see much proof of it yet.
Do you remember the Read-Write story about Facebook logins?
Yes, so, that's a famous story.
If you would be terrified about the way
this is a fantastic story.
So Read-Write Web is this blog that talks about network stuff, and they wrote a story that was very popular about Facebook logging in. And for a day, their search result in Google came above, if you typed Facebook login into Google, their page came above the Facebook login page. And they use Facebook Connect to register comments. And so all of a sudden, on this story, started appearing hundreds of comments from people being like, why did Facebook change the layout again?
This is terrible.
Where are my friends? I don't know what's going on. And it took them a while to figure out that that's what happened, was that people would go to Google, type Facebook login, click the first link, and then click the Facebook button. And if the Google search results get reordered, you're now logging into Read-Write Web instead of Facebook, and they couldn't tell the difference that was a different website.
So I was working
hundreds of people.
So I was working at Read-Write at the time, and the writer is Mike Melanson, and Mike puts up this story, and suddenly we're like, wait, this story's going out of control. It may be like one of the most widely read, the story with the highest number of page views that year. I mean, top 10 at least.
Yeah, so you have to think about convenience. I mean, people want things to be efficient. And even people from computing science, and even researchers, I know some of them, who said, okay, I know it's very bad, but it's so efficient, it's so easy, I have nothing to make, and everything works because someone takes care for me. And this someone can be Facebook, can be Google, can be whoever you want, but they just manage to get all your data and just to provide them to you in nice ways, and so you want them that way. For example, when you use your agenda, it's so efficient that, okay, you stop to install your own because you have to make it connecting to all your devices. And so for that reason, I think that even for the Internet of Things, even all the devices I will have on my own, most people will be very happy if whatever company says, don't worry, we take care of everything for you, just give access to us.
But isn't this a bunch of BS? I mean, this sounds, I mean, I'm, I am a little bit skeptical here because, I mean, you know, we were talking about this earlier. Are you wearing any wearables right now?
No, but I've seen someone with Google Glasses.
One person with Google Glass.
Yeah, one, but it's not
out of 400.
Okay, well, next year, let's have a look for all many people.
All right, we will. So what's your proof today where this is all going to go? I mean, I could talk about theory of the power of the device and the apps and cloud and
the
everything
The states
else.
Know I'm here.
This is basically implanted in me. Like, the fact that it's not physically implanted is an implementation detail. But, like, it's effectively implanted in me.
Yeah, and we know where you are.
Right. Oh, totally. This GSM reports my location. The NSA, my government, sorry, tracks 5 billion GSM locations globally every day. They've saved those data points. 5 billion locations. Like, this reports to the nearest tower.
And every phone call and everything
right.
like that.
Absolutely. Exactly.
So what does that mean? What does that mean? I mean...
That already has the data.
That means that my battery life is terrible.
Thank you, NSA. So the NSA, we might as well talk about the NSA, I mean, come on, is tracking lots and lots of data, right? But so are corporations. Corporations are tracking all kinds of data as well, you know? And you say people are just very laissez-faire and they don't care. Here's the way I would think about it. It's like, I think they don't care. If they don't care in the same way as they don't care about the lock on their house. They think the lock's important, but it's not like you'll come over and say, yo, dude, you got to come over to my house and check out my new lock. It is awesome. But you may say, you know, hey, come on over and check. Yeah, I just brewed my own beer. You got to check this out. You know, and you might have a nice lock on the house because you want your beer protected. But
people understand what a lock is for.
But people want trust at some basic level. They don't want to be exploited.
It's our failure. Like, the Facebook Connect thing is not that people are stupid. It's our failure as technologists to make computing accessible to humans instead of programmers.
There we go.
That's the problem.
Okay. Well, let's talk about the failures. Right. Let's talk about failures.
Yeah. So, like, my mom, for example, I bring this story up all the time because people always use moms as, like, an example. So my mom is not bad at computers. She just has a low tolerance for bullshit. And most computers are, like, full of stuff that is, like, a waste of her time. So naturally, she doesn't care, right? So, like, this is our, like, interface and UX and, like, making things that are useful. Like, it's not that normal people are bad, they just don't care about the details.
How would technology be different if 95% of the programmers were women?
Yeah, right, exactly,
you know,
totally.
Seriously, it would be a much different experience.
Exactly, it's just one example.
So I think... Just want to be careful to not say, like, everyone's dumb because they logged into read-write-web.
Right,
like,
yeah. Yeah, and I think the other thing is we carry this assumption that if I was a node, it would be more complicated. And if I was a node, it would be less usable, and it would be less efficient. Like, we assume the efficiency is the centralized item, right? So some of the other failures are to actually the fact that sometimes we reinforce that. We actually do end up not creating as usable or as effective or as efficient systems unless there's like a big centralized version of that story. So I think we can do much better at that as well. We can, in fact, we
but
might
But why
be able
should
to
we do better?Ourses. Why should we do better? I mean, really, why? I mean, everything's fine right now. We have, you know, look at this conference here. APIs, I mean, it's like, you know, peace, love, and APIs. I mean,
well, NSA is not that fine.
Yeah, it's like, you know, developers are like, you know, the golden people now. I mean, this is the golden age. Why should we care?
We just said,
I mean, everything's going just
great,
isn't it?
We talk about NSA. NSA is not that fine from my point of view. And I think that we have no choice.
I guess the NSA are app developers.
No,
right?
We have no choice. It's going to continue and even to increase. I mean, now it's NSA, but tomorrow the French government will have exactly the same thing, all governments, and then major companies can expect to get many, many things also. And from my point of view, privacy is dead, and don't try to
progress fight. Is dead.
Yeah, privacy is dead.
Privacy.
Yeah,
okay.
Sorry.
Privacy is dead.
And well, the only thing
if
I can...
privacy is dead, maybe progress is dead too.
Okay, and the well, only
now we can make some progress now.
Yeah, it's dead.
So
we
I
can
think
start.
If you want to fight for something, it can be transparency. Like you said, okay, everyone knows everything on me, so I want to know everything about governments, everything about companies. Everything and if everything is transparent, it's going to be a new company, a new world. For us, it's going to be very difficult because we are old. But when I see my students, When I look at my students, they don't give a shit about everything open. And they put the data, and they know that everyone look at them, and they know that it can be used. And as a professor, I said, OK, beware. If you have a photo of you, it can be bad for you later. They don't care.
Well,
maybe they're right.
Is there a difference between transparency and freedom of information, though? I would think there's a big difference. I think I'd rather have freedom of information than, you know, omnipresent transparency, because that seems to be just as bad as...
There is something I heard about, I don't know if it's working still today, but it was an attempt to make companies to give you back all the data they have about you. So to make transparent the fact that I am a company and I'm going to show all the data I get on you, logs, data you gave to me, data you gave to someone else, and I succeeded to get them, and everything is going to be open. So I have two advantages. One, I'm a good guy because I make it transparent. And the second point is maybe these data are not accurate. And if you look at them, maybe you can correct them. And even a third point, which is good for you guys in API, which is maybe all these data, you can make something of them. You can make application using them. I mean, for example, if my phone company can give me all the connection I had in my life on internet, on whatever things, maybe I can do something with all this data. And I mean, hospital or many places, they have plenty of information on me.
So in this context, then, Stephen, you know, what are some of the failures, if, for instance, that you really see, you know, for instance, in the work that you're seeing being done right now, you know, you're right on the cutting edge of, like, you know, a lot of things around, you know, developer movements and, you know, what should be automated, what should not. What are some of the failures that you've really recognized that you think need to be resolved?
Whew.
This is it, you know. You started in the 80s, so,
let's see.
You know.
Let's see. Which approach first? I think that the biggest problem is that computers encourage a binary view of truth. So, for example, there's a news story last week. My deadly disease was a bug in 23andMe.
Oh, yeah.
So 23andMe is like home genetic testing, where you can like swab your cheek and mail it off, and they tell you everything about your genes. And there was a bug in their code, and they told some guy he had like a deadly disease and he had 6 months to live. And so he started making life decisions based on this until he went to an actual doctor, and they said, "What do you don't have that. What's your problem?" And he was like, "The computer told me so," right? So like, because computers are about zeros and ones, we map our data that we collect onto computers, we like assume that they know the truth. And my operating systems professor used to tell me that like the art of operating systems is that the operating system lies to you all the time. It says, "Oh, you have infinite memory. You're the only program running on the system. You can access the network." Like, but it's all lies. It's all a charade, because those things aren't true. So the problem is, as we computerize more and more stuff, we assume that like the logic is like true or false, and that's like a thing, and it's just not like that's not the way the world works. So that's a big problem we have to kind of like get over. The other one, and since I'm in France, I can butcher some French names because I don't speak French. It's terrible. But programmers don't read Michel Foucault and Gilles Deleuze at all. And so, one of the big problems is Google is Microsoft, but because they give us free email, we don't hate them. So, like, again, in the 90s, like, I was, like, reading Slashdot and, like, installing Linux and being like, "Yeah, Microsoft is terrible. We need to, like, get rid of them because they're closed and they're monopolists and they're, like, harming technology," right? Like, Microsoft tried to kill the internet, right? That's why Bill Gates is their, like, richest person alive, is because he almost killed the internet, mankind's crowning achievement. He almost wiped it off the face of the earth. But we forgive him because he's curing malaria with the money he took from us or whatever. So the problem is that it was obvious that Microsoft was closed and that was bad, but Google is open because they exert their influence and control and power in a different way via these decentralized networks and via openness. So Google is not closed source. They just run the W3C and the WG and like have people paid to be on all the standards bodies. Like, they rewrote HTTP in their own image, right? And we just like let them do it.
So they have essentially kind of stamped their, they put their stamp of trust on their APIs, right? So
right.
Like they say, "These work, these are really effective,
Google killed RSS, an open standard that still exists, because it doesn't matter if it's open, it matters who has the control. And so when they like put out Google Reader, which was mediocre enough that we all decided to use it, and then like didn't improve it for years.
Twitter
and
did
then,
its like, part.
Twitter too. Also did its part, yeah. They also implemented the standard, used it to build up their network, and then re-centralized and killed it off. So totally between the two of them. But my point is that like openness is not enough to solve our problems,
so
because it's about power.
So what stamp of trust do you think, Mike, do we need to put on top of those APIs? Because you know, there's this implicit, like the implicit contract I was talking about yesterday,
right.
There's an implicit trust that, oh,
right.
This API will work. I'll be able to get it from point A to point B. But do we need another kind of level of trust put on top of those services so we can, you know, say, you know, so you can actually have be more granular in your level of trust about the service that you're
right.
using?
Right. Actually, I'll answer that, but I want to point out one other thing and encourage people to read this. There's a paper called The Tussle in Cyberspace, and I think it was around 2003. Several people who had built up many parts of the what we call the web, parts of the internet, including DNS and several other things, kind of got together in 2003 after the US bubble crash and sort of said, you know, it looks like this internet thing is going to be a huge commerce thing. Wonder if we really arranged the technical parts of the internet the way we hoped they would turn out. What their idea was that it should be a place where it's a level playing field, where it was very difficult for bullies to take over. And I think one of the things that we're seeing is that hasn't actually worked out. And there's some of the discussion in that paper about how a good example would be DNS was actually conceived as a user set function. So I would decide how I would connect to the internet. But it turned out to be relatively inefficient and kind of complicated, and there were some decisions made about how fiddly it would be for humans to do that. So they centralized DNS. Centralizing DNS has given all sorts of power to people about creating channels and denying access and denying traffic, right? So when you talk about trust, I think, and this is a little bit in that paper, Tussle in Cyberspace. You can look it up. It's a really easy paper to read. But some of that has to do with that sort of notion about centralization. So I think that trust level, if we think about adding one, that's mine, right? That's me deciding what I trust and what I don't. And very often, I think you've touched on this, very often I'm not cognizant, like it's not in the front of my brain, that actually that's me deciding that. A great example would be you go to a site and it says log in with your Facebook account. Right? And we've gotten really comfortable with that, but that's me making a trust decision every time, right? So I think what happens is our data, we talk about the API economy, right? What do we really mean by that? I'm thinking now very often that our data is actually the currency. Like we own this property and we make other people rich when at times when we give it away. So I'm making these trust relationships, and very often what I'm actually doing is letting you mine on my property, right? I'm actually giving you, like, mining rights to my life. So I actually, as sort of a joke, I tweeted last week, an old adage that I was told years ago, if you really love your money, why would you give it to somebody else to manage? Replace money with data. Right, and I think that's the way to think about it.
Big governments aren't really into that whole idea.
Big governments. What did you say? What?
You are not a common internet user. You are someone who thinks. You are someone who knows. So think about the other one. I mean, what do they do?
Well, but maybe that's the idea, right? Maybe that the idea that I talked about should be common. Like we could make that common, or we could make that easier. In other words, we could make it easier for people to realize, be cognizant when they're making that trust decision, right?
Okay, so what's the role of the developer in this emerging future? You know, what is their role? I mean, the developer actually has been quite glorified as kind of the, you know, being able to create these apps that can like solve, you know, all the world's problems, but that really doesn't seem to be true at all.
But the point is that the developers are the ones of power, like everyone. And I mean, if you look at you just talk about Facebook login account. And Facebook login account is very nice for users. I mean, they love it. They just have one account and they can log in everywhere. And of course, the guy who made Facebook login, the developer who did that, I'm sure he gets a huge promotion because now Facebook knows each time you connect to every website. They have the information. So they get plenty of information about what you do every day. And this, as you said, is data which are valuable. So I'm very sorry, but I don't trust developers. I mean, they just want to get powers. Ah. Or they just work for the company, or even if they work on open things, it's a part of their life, and I don't know how it's going to be at the end, and other people are going to take it back. So there are good guys, there are bad guys, and that's life.
I just want to say, you assume that the person who actually made that code work is probably rich because of that.
I'm sure that Facebook liked him.
I'm sure Facebook liked him, but so let me just say something else. That's cute. I liked it. Let me just say something else. It's quite possible that the people who are making it possible to mine this property of mine aren't the ones who profit from it.
Right. We're totally, like, programmers as a class are lackeys to management. We don't question their decisions. We let them pay us really poorly. We give up all of our control, and we do whatever they say. That's life. That's what happens. Yeah, well, I mean, you know, like, we're the ones that build these companies, and then the CEO gets all the money, right? Like, we do all the code
exactly. That
writes the laws of physics that allows our data to get stolen because management tells us they want this feature, and we don't tell them no, we build it.
I cannot agree.
I mean, there's a lot of this
Facebook, who leads Facebook? Developers. Who leads
Right, and Google. And the developers are not making the money.
Yeah, but they are still developers. They are not, as you said, businessmen or whatever.
That's what I mean. They built it, but they don't collect the riches. They get scraps.
Like, anyone
what does
have
Mark
any
Zuckerberg
questions?
Make compared
any
to
questions?
The programmers?
Any questions? Anyone? I have a comment of their own. Okay, we have someone up here. I think I know this guy walking up to the front. I'm starting to see some examples of open source projects that are emerging, for instance, to try to kind of like provide a deeper level of encryption for the individual and developers really, gathering around kind of topics like that. So we can at least, be able to transmit data anonymously, and have that kind of base level encryption too. That protects us as individuals. That's one example that I've been hearing.
Okay, so that's the protection way, and I think that you have also the transparency way. So yes, push data of everyone on the internet, and look about Anonymous. They just take the data from inside of the government, and then they show to everyone. So I think that as not developers, but as a programmer of computers guys. I mean, if we can force transparency everywhere, it's going to be a different world. So, okay, you don't protect everything, but I think it can be much better. I mean, companies and government are not going to do the same bad things if they know that in 1 year it's going to be public.
I also want to pick up on the myth part, right? Because I think you're correct in the sense that we carry stories about other. Like, that's cop. You know, that's CEO, right? So I carry stories in my head. So I think one of the things that I like to do is actually name stuff, like, right? So I think the kind of talking that we're doing actually makes a difference if we treat it as like being just sort of that transparency, that kind of like, well, this is what's on my mind and this is what I'm thinking about, right? Because you learned a lot there, right, at that event. So I think that we need to do more of that, and we can all do that. Like, we can all make it easier to actually communicate and make it easier to name stuff and not actually use that as a bludgeon, right? So I think there's a lot of truth to that. And I think it helps if I name some of like the weird stuff that I think, then people are like, oh, geez, Mike is really screwed up. Let's take Mike in a corner and help him out, right? So I think if we all name stuff more, I think that helps as well.
What you call bullshit is what Zizek calls ideology. And like, if we knew how to defeat ideology, like that is the modern condition. Like the we don't know the answer to that. That is what everybody is wondering, right? Like, why do my parents vote against giving them health care? Right, like that doesn't make any sense. But they do it, and so do many other people. So like, defeating that is a big question that I do not know the answer to. It bums me out on a daily basis. So, yeah. Well, you know, we vote against that too. So,
how much time do we have? Can we keep going? Okay, great. What? Oh, it's time for lunch.
Lunchtime. Yeah. Lunch is delicious.
Well, thank you guys.
Thank you for listening.
Any final? Anything else, Oliver? You want to say? Just okay. Great.
I just want to say you know how to get hold of me, and I would love to talk about more of this anytime.
Thank you, everyone.